Buenos días, vamos a empezar así, aprovechamos esta oportunidad que tenemos hoy para estar toda la mañana o gran parte de la mañana con este invitado que es invitado para nosotros en la Fundación Telefónica. Bueno, contarles que hoy es un día intenso para nosotros, pero es una gran satisfacción porque hoy a la tarde presentamos un libro en la Feria del Libro que se llama Proyecto Facebook y la Post-Universidad, editado por Fundación Telefónica y Editorial Ariel, bajo la dirección de Alejandro Pisitelli, que está acá en la mesa que nos acompaña, compilado por el mismo Pisitelli, por Ivana Daime y Inés Winter. La elaboración de los resultados de este proyecto, que llevó un año de trabajo, sale a la luz hoy con un prólogo de lujo, escrito por uno de los referentes más importantes a nivel mundial sobre e-learning, que es el System Down, y que hoy nos acompaña. Para nosotros es un privilegio que él esté presente hoy con nosotros y en la feria, y que haya aceptado venir a hacer esta presentación especialmente en el espacio de Fundación Telefónica, en el marco del programa de debate y conocimiento de la Fundación, destinado a crear conocimiento, divulgarlo y debatirlo en la sociedad. Nuestro foco es el análisis de las relaciones entre tecnología, sociedad y futuro, en especial el foco en las TICs, las tecnologías de la información y la comunicación, y el modo que están configurando la nueva sociedad de información. Aspiramos a ser una institución de referencia para el público y los estudiosos interesados en el rigor de nuestros análisis y nuestra vocación divulgadora. Antes de dejar a Alejandro Pisitelli para que presente a nuestro invitado de hoy, quiero agradecer muy especialmente a la Embajada de Canadá, que ha permitido que exista en la historia hoy con nosotros. La Embajada es un socio muy importante para nosotros, que trabaja intensamente en la gestión para que esta visita sea posible. Y especialmente a todos que nos acompañen en un horario raro, a las 10 de la mañana es difícil movilizarse, están los lugares de trabajo y de estudio, pero gracias por venir y les sugerimos, les imploramos que aprovechen esta visita porque realmente es un placer tenerlo aquí hoy con nosotros. Gracias.
Gracias, Alejandrina. Recién, hace unos minutos, me entregaron una de las primeras copias que tenemos del libro en papel. Desde ayer a la tarde está circulando el PDF y también el script. Está ya en muchos weblogs y suponemos que va a haber muchísimas bajadas de esta obra, que en particular en su versión en papel es de una calidad excepcional. No se podría hacer algo así sin el apoyo de la Fundación Telefónica. Acá está Carmen Mendillo, acá está representante de la Fundación Telefónica en Chile. Son ese tipo de actividades que sin un sponsoreo y sin este tipo de alianza entre universidad, empresas, fundaciones, no se podrían hacer. Eso desde el punto de vista material. Pero desde el punto de vista más intelectual o conceptual, este libro es el resultado de muchos años de trabajo, si bien físicamente se hizo en un año o algo así, implica una apuesta enorme a la cultura digital, implica una apuesta enorme al rediseño del aula universitaria, implica tomar en consideración que los alumnos que nosotros tenemos ahora, que nosotros tenemos alumnos, chicos que tienen 19, 20, 21 años, tienen una dieta cognitiva totalmente distinta a la que teníamos los adultos, que realmente se aburren en la escuela, se aburren en la universidad, no son interpelados por los métodos de enseñanza y aprendizaje, y se generan fenómenos increíbles que tenían que ser en Argentina, lo que pasó, como fue la rateada en Mendoza del viernes pasado, la convocatoria de la rateada nacional para el día 28 de mayo. Ya salió un juez en Santiago del Estero prohibiendo la rateada, diciendo que van a poner en un corralito a todos los chicos que estén en la plaza y para que los padres los vayan a buscar. O sea, realmente vivimos en una sociedad totalmente esquizofrénica, donde las leyes llegan décadas atrasadas o adelantadas mal, y de alguna manera el tema que nosotros tomamos, esta idea de Facebook, sistemas operativos sociales y entornos abiertos de aprendizaje, que básicamente es una idea que vemos un equipo chico dentro de la cátedra liderado por Ivana Daime y otros compañeros que han trabajado en esto. Acá está Luisa Primavera, tenemos ayudantes que nos acompañan hace muchos años, Gabriela Suez, Estela Halpern, gente muy joven, un equipo prácticamente autoorganizado. Tenemos ahora un equipo de una guerrilla videopunk dentro de la propia cátedra que se trabaja en temas que tienen que ver con su selección de información. Nosotros cuando decidimos hacer esto en diciembre del 2008 era porque Facebook estaba creciendo aceleradamente. En esa época había 140 millones de personas en Facebook, hoy hay 450 millones, quiere decir que fue una buena apuesta. Tuvimos 80 nuevos alumnos el primer cuatrimestre, de los cuales 40 no estaban en Facebook, se metieron para hacer este trabajo. Y yo conocí a Stephen Downs hace un par de años a partir de un amigo común que es Diego Leal. Diego Leal es un chico muy joven, ingeniero, colombiano, que está viviendo en Río de Janeiro ahora, y que lo convocó a Stephen, y tenía contactos con otra gente del entorno virtual de primera línea del mundo, como Nancy White, en el año 2007, para hacer unos talleres que se llamaron Educamp, que se hicieron en ese momento en Colombia, en dos ciudades colombianas, y se repitieron después en el 2008 y en el 2009, en muchas ciudades colombianas. El Educamp es un taller sui generis, es para formación de docentes, puede ser de secundaria, de universidad. Dura un día, nada más. Se hace con laptops y con mucha conectividad en el aula. Y la idea es que en un día un docente con ganas, interesado, despierto, atento a lo que está pasando, pueda aprender a usar unas 15 o 20 herramientas de la web 2.0. No necesita un año, dos años, no necesita 50 manuales, no necesita ritmos diluvianos o ritmos lentos y cansinos, que no son los que hacen falta en este momento. Fue un éxito tremendo esos talleres, con el mérito muy, muy especial del Ministerio de Educación de Colombia, para mi gusto el ministerio más avanzado de América Latina, con una ministra de lujo como es Cecilia Vélez White, que tuvo la intuición y tuvo la valentía de hacer algo que el sistema resiste o el sistema le hace ruido o el sistema le complica. Bueno, ese taller se replicó en Argentina a través de una nativa digital que tenemos en la primera fila, Ana Clara Dalavalle, que lo hizo en Misiones, con docentes, también fue un éxito enorme, y se va a replicar en otros lados. Entonces, bueno, lo conocí a Stephen de nombre ahí, coincidimos en España en un evento que hizo Red.es, un evento enorme que llamó Internet en el Aula, que terminó un fin de semana con cuatro conferencias magistrales en cuatro ciudades españolas simultáneas. Se hizo en Madrid, en Sevilla, en Santander y en Barcelona. Yo estaba en Santander, Stephen estaba en Madrid. Y como las derivas hacen que todos nos encontremos, primero virtualmente, muchas veces después en el mundo real, coincidimos en un seminario fabuloso que hubo en la UOC en diciembre del 2009 sobre entornos personalizados de aprendizaje y estándares abiertos de transmisión de información. Ahí estaba George Siemens, estuvo Stephen, vino gente de Nueva Zelanda, vino gente de Inglaterra. Fue realmente una fiesta de dos días. Y como paralelamente estábamos desarrollando el libro, se me ocurrió que era una buena oportunidad, con la generosidad de la Embajada de Canadá, de invitarlo a Stephen, primero a escribir el prólogo al libro, que circuló primero en inglés y después en castellano. Es un prólogo maravilloso, fantástico, no solamente por el endoso que significó para el proyecto, una persona que tiene como 171 presentaciones en SlideShare. Ay, you are not listening to the translation?
No.
You just listen to Spanish, it's just by osmosis. Okay.
Yeah.
y bueno, lo invitamos y lo tenemos acá, estuvo toda la semana, hizo una gira, como dirían los Beatles, ¿no? Una gira mágica y maravillosa, Michigan Mastery Tour, porque estuvo en Rosario, estuvo en Córdoba, ayer estuvo en Pilar, con unas docentes de inglés, en un encuentro fantástico que se puede estar streameado, así que se puede bajar. Él casi todo lo graba, él es una persona que documenta todo lo que hace, así que está todo streameado, todo grabado, etc. Y la idea de hoy es tener una charla ahora, que ya va a comenzar de inmediato, que durará más o menos una hora y tener una media hora para preguntas, discusiones, comentarios. Y después la seguimos esta tarde con la presentación formal del libro en la feria con el mismo nombre, a las 3:30 de la tarde. Stephen, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, hello everyone.
Hello.
Or... Hola. Okay. So I will stand up here. So let me just get organized. I'll use that mic.
This mic.
You'd rather I held the microphone. Yeah. So, okay. Not a problem. And So as you can see, we are broadcasting live to a worldwide audience of 27 people. So this is the you know, and we're just sort of messing around here. This is totally impromptu. I didn't advertise this or anything, but this is the sort of concept that I want to talk about today, is doing this kind of thing. Alejandro mentioned edupunk in his introduction, and he really should turn off the audio on his computer. Thanks. You know, it's this whole idea of doing it yourself, and doing it yourself and making things happen for yourself rather than depending on organizers or others to do it for you. And so we didn't, well, we sort of asked a little bit whether we were allowed to do this, but mostly I just found ambient wireless connection in the room. I determined very quickly that it was very good connection. I was very happy about that. And so consequently, I figured, great, we'll live stream it. Why not? And we'll record the video. And I'm also recording the audio, and I'm recording the Spanish translation in the back of the room there. And so we're creating learning objects on the fly. And this is an important fundamental lesson because, you know, I mean, the topic of the talk is culturality and connectivism. I don't talk about culturality a lot, and I think maybe I should talk about it a bit more. But, you know, I think the first and most important lesson of culture is that it belongs to the people, it belongs to us, it is what we make it, and we have tools now more than ever than we did in the past to make culture. Now, I need to be sensitive as to my screen positioning here. It's interesting, you're recording audio, recording video, you sort of have to keep your mind on a bunch of things at once. So, and I don't want to give them a really bad video experience. So if I have been, sorry about that. So, without further ado, this should just pop right in there. There we go. You know, when we think about culture, and when we think about things like community, or nationality, or even language and linguistic groups like we do a lot in my own country, we tend to think of these things as undivided wholes of instances of commonality, where everybody is the same in some sort of essential, important way. You know, think about the nationalism of being English or French or whatever, and the idea is, you know, all the English people have to share the same sort of English cultural values. All the French people share slightly different cultural values. But, you know, when you look at these elements of culture and you study these elements of culture, you find that culture does not break down into this nice, neat set of groups and categories. Look at this network up here on the screen. This is a network of Western European languages. And the main thing you should see, and this is something you know already, all of these languages are related to each other. They all derive from versions of each other. This is only a very partial chart of these languages. And really, if you were going to draw a full chart of these languages, you know, this is just the derivation of different languages from sources. But, you know, if you were to map the influence from one language to another language to another language, you would get a very complex diagram. And in fact, the culture of any individual person is composed not of metallic, like, elemental forms of being that are indivisible and separate and pure. The culture of any individual, any person you care to name, all of you, myself, Alejandro, the people in the back of the room, the guy recording the video, this culture is a mixture of all cultures, each to a different degree, and all of these cultures related to each other the way the words in a language all relate to each other. And this is true not just of language, but of culture generally. I love this diagram. This is one of my favorite diagrams in the entire world. It's almost impossible to read. On the slide, it turns out a bit better. All of those dots, each dot represents a scholarly domain. There's philosophy is there. We've got child psychology over here. We've got anthropology, archaeology. Over here, we've got electrochemistry, polymers, organic chemistry. Down here in the green, we have psychology. This is a map, and on the screen, if you look at the slides later, on the screen there are little white lines connecting all of these dots. It's a huge network. And this is an actual representation of papers in one discipline that cite or refer to papers in another discipline. Now, when we think of a domain or a discipline like psychology, say, or geography, our first instinct is to think of it like a culture or a nationality, you know, and, you know, like you, you know, I'm sure you all say, you know, those geographers are a strange bunch, or, you know, engineers can't be trusted, right? But really, when you look at the composition of these disciplines, they are composed of links to the other. So culture and discipline and a wide variety of social and community phenomena like that are based not in some sort of essential nature of being, but rather based in connections with other entities of a similar type. They're clusters located in a network rather than standalone, we are all united kind of groups. And it's an interesting picture, and I think it's an important picture because this runs directly contrary to the sort of nationalism or regionalism or communitarianism that you might see depicted in your newspaper and used for not so savory political purposes. You know, we are more alike than we are different from other cultures. And, you know, the things that divide us really can be defined through these links. If we understand that our culture, our nationality, our language, our domains, our disciplines, are clusters in a network, then we think of these things differently. I have a diagram in Spanish, how about that? Now, I'm not gonna spend a whole lot of time on this. Again, you can come back to the slides and find this. This is a diagram I created in New Zealand, and I originally created it in English, and then it was kindly translated for me into Spanish, and also he made it look a lot nicer. The writing is a lot nicer. And what I want to do with this diagram is to draw what I think is a fundamental distinction. Now, this distinction is not unique to me. I did not invent this distinction. I've just drawn it out and tried to clarify it for my own thinking. And it's not necessarily the way of the world. It's just a way of looking at these sorts of issues. And on the left, we have groups. This is your traditional nationalistic, we are all the same kind of definition of community. And on the right, we have networks. And this is what I believe is a more appropriate, more reflective, more realistic description of culture and community. There are different dimensions across these, and I identify four major ones, which I'll talk about briefly in the next few slides. The first major dimension is diversity. And, you know, one of the things that I've inherited from my culture in Canada is a desire for diversity. And this is a value that has been deliberately shared and talked about and created and generated across Canada. And I've always felt that, now I'm using Alejandro's slides to position myself here back into the screen. this is kind of fun. I have always felt and always believed that you need a mixture of materials, you need a collection of different perspectives, different points of view, in order to come to any new understanding. You know, think of a conversation. Think of a discussion you have back and forth with your friends. And probably in that discussion, you will create new knowledge, right? And that's the whole idea of having such a discussion. But suppose you knew exactly the same thing as your friend. What would you and your friend talk about? You know all the same things. You think all the same things. You know, one person would say something, you know, blah, 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 you know, yeah, I knew that, blah, 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 yeah, I knew that, right? You need to have different perspectives and point of views even to have a conversation, much less to create a community or to create new knowledge. Diversity is essential to community. So what's important about a community is not the way everybody is the same. What's important about a community is the way everybody is different and able to connect to each other. Good communities are open. Closed systems, closed communities become stagnant. Imagine if nobody was allowed to come in or out of the city, even a big city like Buenos Aires. Eventually, you would lock out or freeze up the source of new ideas. It would become like an echo chamber, kind of like this room. I like how I've described that. The system becomes clogged with the quote-unquote creative product of its members. Communities have to be open. They have to have some source of new material coming in, whether it's raw material, resources, ideas, etc., and they have to have some place where they can send their creative product, the things that they make, the ideas that they have. Openness is essential to community. Again, with this traditional kind of group identity kind of description of culture, there's this inclination or desire to close off a culture from the rest of the world. But when you do that, you know, you become like North Korea, right? You become isolated, you become unable to cope with even your own internal society. A third criterion that distinguishes a community defined as a network from a community defined as a group is autonomy. And what that means is that each of the members of that community are working toward their own sense of values, their own sense of purpose, their own goals or endeavors. Now, that does not mean there cannot be a common purpose, right? People can choose to work together. What it does mean is that a common purpose or a common goal does not define the community. And, you know, we have various people from corporations here. One of the first things corporations like to do is create a vision statement and then a strategic plan, etc., that everybody in a corporation will line up behind. But this is actually kind of an artificial reality, a fantasy land, because if we think about any corporation that we know of, all of the people in the corporation are working at the corporation for different reasons. They're not all lined up behind the vision statement, the strategic plan, right? I don't wake up in the morning thinking, I want to increase the effectiveness and foster productivity for my cultural base, right? That, nobody does that. It's like, I need to get some milk, and that's why I got up today. And to get some milk, I have to go work because I won't get milk, I won't get paid otherwise, you know? So it's better to recognize that and better to understand that even a cohesive organization like a corporation is not united behind a single goal, but rather is a collection of autonomous but cooperating individuals. And that's the key. We hear a lot about collaboration, but I like to distinguish collaboration from cooperation. And cooperation is a mutual, is an exchange of mutual value between autonomous individuals, rather than collaboration, where the two individuals subsume themselves under a single common goal. Now, again, there is room for voluntary collaboration. I'm not eliminating it out of the scope of the world, but collaboration, working together, does not define community. Community is based on each of us following our own way. As Star Trek would say, it's infinite diversity and infinite combinations. Or as John Stuart Mill would say, each person pursuing his or her own good in his or her own way. Finally, the fourth major dimension of, boy, this gets heavy after a while. I don't know how senators do it. I guess they practice. Yeah. The fourth major feature distinguishing a network-based community from a group-based community is interactivity. And this is a bit tricky, but this is a concept that's going to underlie a lot of the rest of this talk. And so I want to draw it out a little bit. Now, there are different ways we can think of the way ideas are created and spread through a community. One way is what we might call the broadcast method. And here's how it works. I have an idea, say the earth is square. Doesn't have to be a true idea, it could just be any idea. And then what I say is the earth is square, and then I say it to you. And so you in the front row, you all say, you all agree the earth is square, and you say it and you pass it on. And then soon everybody in the room is saying the earth is square, right? So now what has happened here is that the idea of one individual has been propagated through the group and then has become part of the group's knowledge. Now, you can see the limitation of that. It means that we, as a group, cannot know more than any individual can know, right? Because the idea has to be formed in my head, in my mind first, or maybe in one of yours, it depends on how democratic we are, but still, it's the same kind of thing, right? Formed in my head and then spread to each of you. In philosophy, we would call this as well a fallacy of composition, making the properties of the group the same as the properties of the individual. The idea of the group will be an idea that was had by one individual. This is how groups operate. This is how systems based on identity and conformity operate, but they have this upper structural limitation. Now, imagine we wanted to have a really complex idea, a really complex kind of knowledge. Well, we can't do it the way I've just described, because it's the sort of knowledge that's going to go beyond what I could have from my one perspective or one point of view. It goes beyond what can be known by one person. I'll give an example. Flying an airplane from Toronto to Buenos Aires. You might think, oh yeah, sure, that's no problem. Anybody can do that. Right? Well, let's make it a big airplane. Let's make it a 747. That's a big airplane. Okay, so think of that concept. Think of the knowledge that it takes to do that. Could that knowledge be contained by any one individual? Clearly not, right? What we need to do is create a mechanism where the knowledge is not contained by any one person, but rather, as they say, emerges from the interactions among the people. So we'll all have our own bit of knowledge, our own perspective on how to fly this airplane. Somebody is the pilot, somebody is the co-pilot, somebody is the navigator, somebody is the flight attendant, somebody makes the tires that the plane lands on, somebody builds the windscreen, somebody washes the windscreen, somebody serves vodka to the first class passengers and water to the rest. Somebody sits in the control tower and manages the plane traffic, and then there's the guy who, when the plane's coming in, he waves his hand and says, park here. Right? It takes all of these different perspectives, different bits of knowledge to create the social knowledge of how to fly this airplane. There's a wide variety of knowledge like that. And it's important to understand that it's not simply a joining of individual knowledge, it's rather new knowledge that did not exist and could not exist in any individual perspective. It's, as I said, emergent knowledge. And I'll talk a little bit about that as the talk progresses. But essentially, the idea of emergent knowledge is that it is the pattern that is created by a set of interconnected entities. So this knowledge, because it is a pattern, does not exist in itself. It has to be recognized by a viewer. Yesterday I was talking about how knowing is recognizing. This is what this is. And look at, for example, your television. Think about watching a program on your television. And you see a picture of Richard Nixon on your television. You all know who Richard Nixon is, right? Well, it doesn't matter. Well, it does matter. So really what you're looking at is a whole bunch of pixels, right? Little dots on the screen. And the reason why you recognize a picture of Richard Nixon is because they're organized in a certain way. No individual pixel has a picture of Richard Nixon. In fact, it couldn't possibly, because a pixel can only have like 3 or 4 values of color. And what's important is not only the organization, but you need to recognize that, yes, this is in fact Richard Nixon, right? If you did not know who Richard Nixon was, then when you look at the pixels, it's just some guy who looks a little nervous. And if you were an alien from outer space, you might not even recognize that this is a human. So this is the sort of thing. The image of Richard Nixon emerges from the pixels. Our knowledge of how to fly a 747 emerges from the individual knowledge. But this knowledge does not exist in itself. It has to be recognized as existing. So that's what I mean by interactivity. When I say interactivity, I say the knowledge in the community is created by the interaction of the members of the community rather than created in one person and then spread through the community. Does that make sense? All right. Deep breath. Because, you know, that's a bit much to take before 10 o'clock or before 11 o'clock in the morning. Now, the theory of connectivist teaching and learning is based on the idea, based on two ideas. First of all, the idea that the human brain is a network, just like the networks I've described. It's a whole bunch of individual entities, neurons, connected with each other. And knowledge in the human brain emerges from these connections. And then the second idea is that our communities, our sociality, our culturality, is that a word? I don't know if that's a word. It's in the title, but I don't know if it's a word. Again, is created through these connections. So the way we have cultural identity, the way we have language and science and research and reasoning in our society generally, is the same mechanism as the way we have knowledge individually or personally. Same system. We're using the same system, the same logic, the same sort of idea. And when you think about it, that has to be the case. You know, think about a neuron, just for a second. Neurons are really stupid. All a neuron can do is receive an electrochemical potential and then decide whether or not it's going to fire. And, well, that's the life of a neuron. It doesn't know why it's firing. It has no idea about the world or, you know, even the neurons next to it. All it knows is if it gets enough signals coming in, it's going to fire. And over time, depending on the signals that come in, it might form connections with other neurons. But it just sort of does that because of physics and chemistry. It doesn't want to form connections. It just does form connections. It's just a matter of biology. That's it. So neurons are really stupid. If all you could think of was what one of your neurons could contain, you could not even get out of bed in the morning. You know, you'd be lying there in bed. Because that's all a neuron can do. So our knowledge, our intelligence must be based on something emergent from the connective activity of many individual neurons. Can't be based on the content of a neuron, has to be based on the pattern of connectivity of these neurons. We replicate that in connectivist teaching. We form a network in which individuals act as though they were neurons. And what they are trying to do in this network is to receive signals, process signals, send signals, and connect with other people. Very simple activities. That's the key. It's really easy to get off track on one of these talks, right? Because there's always a reason. And I can follow the train of reasoning, and we go back to first there's a hydrogen atom, and then anyhow. So here's what a connectivist course looks like. It's also what a personal learning environment looks like. A personal learning environment is the environment you would use to learn in a connectivist manner. I see. What I do is I watch the guy taking the photograph and then and the trick is to get the timing right. So here's you at the center. It's represented in this case by Elk, because the people from Elk created this diagram. It's a version of the diagram created by Scott Wilson. And then you at the center are connected to all kinds of different things, different people, different applications online. So you're connected to social networking, you're connected to communities, you're connected to your own files, to search, to web logging, and so on. All kinds of different services. You should think of it as you being connected to other people. And everything else is just physics and biology, mechanisms for you to be able to send messages to other people and other people to send messages to you. It's a big communications network. That's what a connectivist course is. Now, remember how I distinguished between groups and networks? There is a corresponding difference between two types of knowledge. There is the traditional type of knowledge that people have always tried to teach you in a classroom, and then there's this new network kind of knowledge that I've been talking about. Think about the kind of knowledge that even today people think should be learned in schools. It's static, right? They want to teach people things, you know, basic first principles, foundational knowledge, stuff that doesn't change. 2 + 2 = 4. Make that the knowledge that you learn. It's declarative. It's kind of a hard concept, but what I mean is it is a set of propositions or a set of statements of fact. So the idea here of this kind of knowledge is that when you learn, learning is the accumulation or collecting of a set of facts. As Wittgenstein in his earlier incorrect days, he said the world is a totality of facts. And the educational version would be an education is a totality of facts. That's the old way of looking at education. And then it's authority-based. The idea is the contents of one person's mind will be sent to other people. I know that the world is a square, and I will teach you and you and you that the world is a square. That's the old way of looking at knowledge. That's the way of looking at knowledge where the idea of teaching is to make everybody the same. But that's not productive of community. In fact, it's destructive of community. It makes communities stagnate and die rather than grow and prosper. So I'm more interested in another kind of knowledge, which is knowledge in the network. Knowledge in the network has, well, many properties, but these three properties are pretty key. First of all, it's dynamic. What we mean by that is it's always changing. What was true yesterday may be true tomorrow. What was true tomorrow may be true the next day. Even if there are underlying facts in the matter, even if 2 plus 2 is always equal to 4, it's not always relevant. It might not always matter. There are always facts out there in the world. The world may not be a totality of facts, but it has a lot of them. But these facts come in and out of relevance, come in and out of prominence. So even if there are unchanging parts of the world, our relationship to these things changes. Knowledge is also what we call tacit or non-declarative. The idea of tacit knowledge is an idea from Michael Polanyi. I always have to be careful because there's a Canadian physicist called John Polanyi, and I tend to confuse them. And a way of describing it is ineffable. It's knowledge that quite literally cannot be represented in words, because we do not have sentences in the brain. We may think in sentences, or we may think in the experience of reading or hearing sentences, but remember, we just agreed earlier, we have neurons in the brain, and that our knowledge is composed of the connections between these neurons. These connections are not sentences. These connections are distributed across tens of thousands, millions of neurons. And the kind of knowledge that we can have is much more complex, much more multifaceted, much more, much more whatever than we can express in a sentence.
Kaleidoscopic,
yeah, that's a good word. Think of, there's all kinds of things. What was the example I had yesterday? You could sit there all day and talk about how to do something, but, there's all kinds of examples. Like riding a bicycle is the example Polanyi used. I can sit here all day and describe to you how to ride a bicycle, but really, riding a bicycle is something you have to learn by getting on the bicycle and riding it. Because the language that I use to describe how to ride a bicycle does not completely describe how to ride a bicycle. And then finally, knowledge in the network is constructed. And I should probably not say constructed so much as grown. Knowledge in the network results from the entities in the network interacting with each other and new connections being formed. In the human mind, knowledge is created when we create connections between neurons, one neuron to another. Socially, social knowledge, that is created when we connect individuals, one individual to another individual. So far, so good? Still pretty rough for before noon, isn't it? So here we are. Here's our personal learning environments. Each one of these is... is one of these. So these things are connected to each other in this network. We can also think of each one of these as a different person, or we can also think of each one of these as a different way that you yourself are connecting to the network. It's complex, right? It's not simple. But the main thing we have here is we have individuals that are connected to each other through a variety of technologies. That's the main thing to think of here. So what happens when we think about teaching and learning in this sort of network is that the role of teachers and learners is to participate in the workings of this network. That is the activity that we are undertaking. One of the things you should notice is almost in the way I'm describing this, the activity of teachers becomes the same as the activity of students. They're not two separate activities, They merge, they become one in the same activity. Okay, now, so I've mapped out this discussion. You've probably seen elements of this discussion in a lot of the other stuff that you've seen or read. The next step that most people take, including, I might add, George Siemens and others, is to say, okay, we've described networks, we've described social networks, now we're, you know, all learning is social, therefore we're going to talk about social learning. And so our theory of learning will be a description of learning in social networks. Now this is a turn that I do not take. This is a way that my approach to learning in networks is different or distinct from other people's. Where other people go at this point is one of a number of different directions, and I've listed a few here. There's the old behaviorist or instructivist method of, you know, transmitting knowledge. This is Skinner and all of those guys. Gilbert Ryle, concept of mind. There's a whole host of them where learning is behaving. I had a comment in my blog just the other day. It said, it begins, well, we can agree that we know someone has learned when they are behaving in a certain way. I'm sort of, oh yeah, right. And here we go again. Right. Other people have become more advanced, and we have Moore, for example. G.E. Moore bases his theory of learning very much on information theory. It's interesting. My background is in philosophy and science, not educational theory. So I approached Moore late in life. I read Moore, and my reaction was, this is a checksum network. This is sending a signal, sending back a confirmation, and so on. So Moore's theory is actually based on a protocol for information and communication. Yeah, pretty useful as far as that goes, but you know, it's an externalist-based social learning kind of theory. Then you can get, you know, more complex, more interesting forms of social learning. Social constructivism from Vygotsky and others, problem-based learning, and I can go on. You know, these are all the fairly standard theories of learning that everybody learns when they study education or learn about pedagogy. I do not go in this direction. Okay, just think about this social learning. Think about where the models of knowledge and learning are coming from. Well, we have externally based definitions or community based definitions. Learning objectives will be defined by the community. What counts as a body of knowledge will be defined by the community. The processes are externally based. The processes of learning are going to be defined by the community. They're all like activities, conversations, interaction, communication. Everything is happening external to the person, right? We have external systems. We define learning in terms of classes, even in terms of networks, groups, collaborations, all kinds of things that are happening outside the individual person. And of course, evaluation is by somebody external to you, an examiner or something like that. It's as though the entire process of learning happens in the society, in the community, and nothing happens in your head. And that just seems wrong to me. Because throughout this talk, I've been careful to distinguish between the knowledge in our head that is formed by connections and neurons, and the knowledge in society that is formed by connections and people. And the learning that happens in our head does not consist of connections between people. The connections between people is the learning society or a community as a whole does. The learning that we do as individuals is different from that. It is the growing of connections in our own mind. Very different. Social knowledge, the knowledge of a society, the knowledge of a culture, the knowledge of a community is not the same as personal knowledge. Social knowledge emerges from the connections created by many individual persons. Two distinct things. They're related, they're connected, but they're not the same. So we have different kinds of learning, different kinds of knowledge management. Personal knowledge management is learning. Social knowledge management might be research or social learning or something like that. So the key thing that I want to underline here that makes my approach to education a bit distinct from many other people's is that the product of the educational system is not a social outcome. And it's interesting because when you think about how people define what the objectives of an educational system ought to be, they are so often social and cultural objectives. We want everyone to know our underlying social values. We want everyone to know mathematics. We want everyone to be able to take part in the creation of a jumbo jet that flies from New York to Buenos Aires. Right? They're all socially defined. But learning is in fact a personal outcome, not a social outcome. It's like having the picture of Richard Nixon tell the pixels what they ought to be. So how does this work? Here's the picture. Here's the picture of connectivism my way. I think George is still working on this. I don't think he disagrees, but I don't know if he agrees. When I say George, I'm referring to George Siemens, who's my partner in crime. So what do we got? We have a social network. We have a personal learning environment. We're all connected. We're having communications back and forth. We're receiving content, signals, input. We're manipulating it. We're creating it. We're sending messages to all the other people who are our friends. We're working in the social network. But we're using the social network to create in ourselves a neural network. It's just like exercising with a barbell. Do I have something handy? Whoops. Okay. Pretend this is a barbell, right? So I'm exercising. I don't want to become one of these. Right? That would be ridiculous, right? But I use this in order to develop the muscle. So I use something external to myself in order to develop an internal capacity. There needs to be some kind of consistency. A barbell has to be something I can lift and hold. The external properties, you know, the gravity, the weight of the barbell, are important to the formation of the muscle, but they are not the same. Personal knowledge consists of neural connections, not social connections. Very important. The reason why this is important is because when we understand personal knowledge as neural connections, then personal knowledge does not consist of the artifacts that we use to describe social knowledge. The artifact that we use to describe social knowledge might be a sentence. Paris is the capital of France. But represented personally in our own mind, in our own neural network, it might look like that. And this is not simply the representation, Paris is the capital of France, it's also the representation, cows are brown. And it's also the representation, water is wet. Or as the old joke goes, yeah, fish are wet, and they don't even know it. Okay, I thought that was a scream. What's happening here, there's two things happening here. First, this is non-propositional, non-sentential, non-explicit. It's tacit. It's ineffable. There are no words here. Second, it is distributed. There's no particular place that corresponds to the knowledge that Paris is the capital of France. And this knowledge is embedded with other knowledge that semantically is not even related to it. And it results in funny things. It means that if I tell you my dog is white, your understanding of Paris changes a little bit. You know, how does that make any sense? Well, my understanding, like your understanding of dog is in here, and your understanding of Paris is in here. If I change your understanding of dog, it changes your understanding of Paris a bit. That's what we mean by complex. You can't do just a simple cause-effect kind of thing. When you have complex knowledge, you have situations like this where you can't just get at one element of knowledge in isolation from all the rest. This makes a total mash, as an aside, a total mash of traditional educational research. It's the difference between knowing that Paris is the capital of France, or even know how to do something, and what it feels like to know the capital of France. When you think about that, right, you know, you all know the capital of France, right? Well, you must. I've told it to you 3 or 4 times already. If you've forgotten it, now you're in deep trouble. Right? But there's a difference between knowing this as a fact and knowing what it feels like to get the answer right when somebody asks you, what is the capital of France? Right? And it's this feeling, this overall, this full mind kind of sensation that is the actual knowledge. The sentence, Paris is the capital of France, is just the social artifact that we produce. It's public knowledge, it's social knowledge, but it's not personal knowledge. Learning a discipline, like geography or psychology or any of these things, is a total state. It's a transformation of the self from somebody who was not a geographer to somebody who is a geographer. It's not a collection of individual bits of knowledge. It's a process of becoming something. We grow our internal state in such a way that at the end of that growth, we're able to say, I'm a philosopher, or a geographer, or whatever. The question is, how do we know? Typically, we give people tests, right? We ask them for social artifacts. We ask them for very simple propositional social artifacts. Write a sentence, answer a question, create an essay. Real simple, you know, and there's all kinds of ways for a person to correctly produce the social artifact without actually having become the thing that they're trying to become. People are good on tests, they're bad at the profession. I'm sure you've seen that. Learning to become a geographer or a philosopher or whatever occurs not by presenting people with a set of facts, but by immersing themselves in the discipline. By joining the community of geographers or the community of philosophers and taking part in the wide range of interactions typical of that community. It's like learning a language, right? I can sit there and describe all the elements of learning Spanish, but really, to learn the language, you need to get into the language community and actually speak the language. And that's when you learn the nuances of the language. You know, the subtleties of pronunciation, the appropriateness of certain words at certain times, so on. It's expressed functionally rather than cognitively. Can you act as a geographer in a network of geographers? Or, you know, you sort of ask the question, if you were to stand there in a group of physicists and talk about physics to them, would you stand out as somebody who knew what you didn't know what you were talking about, or would they all accept you as a physicist? Right? It's that kind of thing. You know, it's not, can you state a whole bunch of facts related to geography? Or it's like teaching, right? It's like, if you stood in the front of a room and started teaching and other people who were teachers were watching you, would they accept that you knew what you were doing, or would they say, this person is not a teacher, they have no idea what they're doing? You see how the community recognizes whether or not a person is a teacher, whether or not a person is a geographer. It's like seeing that pattern, that complex pattern of associated behaviors, actions, reactions, inclinations, and all of the rest, they are recognized as being such and such a kind of person. That's why when it really becomes important that somebody know what they do, we don't just give them a test. You know, airline pilots, right? We don't give them a true-false quiz and then let them fly an airplane. We don't let them write an essay answer and fly an airplane. We put them in a simulator. We immerse them, and then we actually put them in a real airplane without passengers in it and see if they can fly the airplane. Similarly with doctors, right? We don't just take a doctor straight from a test to the operating room. They have to go through a long internship where other doctors look at them, watch all the different things that they do, and recognize, yes, this person is a doctor. In other words, we evaluate whether a person has developed the appropriate neural network, the appropriate personal knowledge, by their performance overall in a community, in a network. So it's not the specific bits of performance, and this is one of the reasons why I'm worried about competencies. I'm worried about breaking things down into more and more precisely defined disciplines, right? It's not the little bits of knowledge that they might have. It's how they function when immersed into the environment. Now, how do you know that a person can swim? They can tell you everything they know about swimming, but you don't know that they can swim until you put them in the water and see whether they sink or not. That's the deciding factor. And then you put them in the water. Anybody can tell, right? Oh yeah, that person's swimming. Or, oh, that person's drowning. You know, didn't matter whether they passed the test. Personal knowledge is not social knowledge. It does not consist of social artifacts. It is not constructed the way we construct a sentence. It is not built the way we build a house. It is not organized the way we organize a society. It is grown the way we grow a muscle. And so the method, the activity of learning, is appropriate to that kind of knowledge. Standing there, even like I'm doing here, and spouting a bunch of facts at people doesn't produce personal knowledge. It might produce little bits of social artifacts that they may or may not remember, but it's not going to produce the knowledge. The very best you can do is to induce or stimulate some kind of thinking, right? I can't take a sentence and put it in your head. Not possible. Even though I may look like I'm really trying to do that right now, and you notice how even leaning forward, and that's probably not good on video, and even leaning forward and trying to push it into your head, it's not happening. You're all reacting in your own individual, unique ways. Some of you are smiling, some of you are laughing, some of you in the back are shaking your head. You know, that's okay. And I can't put my knowledge in you. All I can do is give you various stimulations that get you thinking. And it's just a part of your overall social experience. And it's your overall social experience that will produce the knowledge. What we're doing here is part of the practice of a discipline as a whole. And by participating in that discipline, we're becoming a little bit more able to work in that discipline. So the way to think of a personal learning environment in this context is as an exercise machine, a way to immerse yourself in a community and work with the community, to get yourself into a community and start practicing with the community. You would use your personal learning environment if you wanted to become a geographer. You would use your personal learning environment and connect to the community of geographers. You wouldn't sign up for a geography class. Well, you might, but that wouldn't be your education. Your education would be to start listening to and watching geographers, and then sort of tentatively at first, and then more and more, practice doing the things that geographers do. you can learn philosophy in the same way. And in fact, this is what we do in philosophy. That's why philosophy is so cool, right? Because, you know, in philosophy, nobody spouts a bunch of facts at you and expects anyone to believe it. You know, the whole act of philosophy is doubting what you're told, right? But what happens is we, as philosophers, immerse ourselves in this environment. We put ourselves into proximity with other philosophers, and then we argue back and forth like crazy, usually over copious quantities of beer, because that's what philosophers do, which is why their lives are so short. And gradually, you become more and more capable of being a philosopher, more and more adept at the practices, the method of speaking, the language, the jargon, the worldview, the way of thinking, all of these things of the community of philosophers. And not only that, you will actually become, through that process, an empiricist, or a rationalist, or a realist. You'll actually become affiliated with a subdomain and become a part of a community, become a part of a culture or a society within philosophy by gradually developing a greater affinity for that group, gradually becoming more and more like members of that group. And it's not like they told you, you will be a realist. It's you determining your own path, your own direction, first to become a philosopher and then to become a realist, which I would never do. Developing personal knowledge is like exercising, much more like exercising than inputting, absorbing, remembering. Your personal growth, your exercise, develops as a consequence of your interactions with the rest of the community. And so we have the connectivist course, quote unquote. It's not really a course, really. In a connectivist course, like the course that George and I taught, Connectivism and Connective Knowledge, or like the course that I'm starting in June called Critical Literacies, we don't teach information. We don't have content that we want to pass along. Rather, the content, that's always worrying. The content, okay, then I'll just lower this. You turn up the volume, I move them up. Action, reaction. Five minutes. Yeah, I'm getting it. So, in a connectivist course, the content of the course is created by the members of the course themselves. Now, that includes the instructors. Like, it's not like constructivism where instructors are guided by the side. None of that. It doesn't work unless the instructors take part too. Because if you think about how a community works, right? In a community, like a community of geographers, the alpha geographers are in there slugging it out and arguing geography back and forth with other geographers. I can draw better maps than you can, here, look, right? And then all the other geographers that are less alpha or just learning to be geographers, they're in the same community. So the instructors and the students are in the same place. They're creating the same content, working with the same content. So in critical literacies, I'll be in there creating content. And I'm sure people will read the content I create, but students will be creating content as well. And together, through our individual actions, we create this community, this society, or this culture around the idea of critical literacy. We don't tell students to perform specific tasks, right? Rather, what happens is they are presented with the things that other people create, and they do with them whatever they think is relevant. Now, what will they do? Well, that depends on their experience in the course. It depends on who they're watching, who they're following, who they're using as models or mentors, who they're trying to imitate, or whether they're trying to imitate at all. The idea is that they, in their own unique way, are working with the content and the materials that constitute that discipline. What will happen a lot of the time, most of the time, if you're lucky, is they will change the discipline. They will add something unique that we've never seen in the discipline before, and the discipline will grow and develop. You know, a lot of people in different disciplines have their greatest ideas, their unique contributions to a discipline they originally formed when they're students. There's all this network stuff that I do originally formed in my own mind when I was a student. I've pursued it ever since, but it was as a student, instead of following the typical cognitivist, we have sentences in our brains line, I went a different direction because I felt that was more appropriate, working with philosophers and educators, gradually building my own perspective on the matter. Typically, in a connectivist course, a student would do some sort of common activities, reading, posting comments, creating, blogging, contributing content to a wiki. They don't have to do this, but empirically, what we observe is that a large number of them do this. But also, what we have observed empirically through different offerings of connectivist-style courses is that students will engage in a large and unpredictable set of activities. They may create a map of course participants. They may host a seminar, Second Life. In the connectivism course, we had three separate Spanish language subgroups formed in the course, including the connectivitas, which I thought was kind of cool, and the Second Life stuff. People created Google groups, Yahoo groups, translated stuff, created concept maps, and more, right? And this is the idea, when you're not located in any particular place, when you're not set in any particular environment, when all you have to do to participate in the course is connect in some way to it, you can use any application, any location, any forum, any way of communicating or working with ideas, and then it connects back to the whole, and it adds a uniqueness, a unique perspective to the whole. A connectivist course, very important, is not a bunch of people marching lockstep through the same activities. Learning design is anathema to connectivism. I threw that word in just for the translators. It's not everybody doing the same thing. In a connectivist course, everybody does different things. And there even isn't a sense of everybody. Sometimes people are in the course, sometimes they're not. They may start the course and not finish. They may finish the course without having started. It doesn't matter. It's understood, expected, that students will undertake different activities in different times, that their learning will emerge as a process of these activities, and just as importantly, our social understanding of the subject matter will also grow. Again, it's not a static set of course content. Our knowledge of the course content grows every time we offer the course. So, a connectivist course basically has two major modes. First of all, the creation of an environment. This is the personal learning environment. An environment that fosters or supports great diversity and autonomy in participation. An environment that is also open, very important. You can't close a barrier to a connective course. It has to be open so people and ideas can flow in and out. And it's based on the idea of interaction between people and a large and undefinable body of materials. And then secondly, in this environment, people do their own things, create interactions with each other, and new and unexpected, typically unexpected knowledge, flows out of it as a result. And so that, meeting Alejandro's 5-minute deadline, pretty good, huh? Is the talk that I wanted to offer you today, and I think we'll have some time for comments and questions, and I hope the people who are online on UStream enjoyed that. But we'll see. See if there's anyone left. Yeah. 161.
Bueno, estaba mirando acá, hubo más o menos durante esta hora unos 100 tweets
Y, o sea, 100, decenas de personas que mandaron tweets, entre ellas dos personas, una dentro de la sala, que fue Luz Pearson, está ahí adelante, que ella siguió el segundo curso que hizo Stephen sobre el conectivismo, y el otro fue Diego Leal, que habíamos mencionado antes, que no solamente tuiteó, sino que hizo una serie de comentarios, a veces con dudas, muchas veces remarcando, ¿no? Por ejemplo, cita a Stephen, ¿no? Que dice, no pedimos, Stephen dijo, no pedimos a los participantes que hagan una tarea en particular, se presentan recursos para que decidan qué hacer con ellos. Y Leal dice, de esta perspectiva no se parece a lo que hago, tengo actividades definidas, pero serán mi manera de wayfinding, ¿no? Encontrar el camino. Como creo que quedó más que de manifiesto, Stephen tiene una particularidad, no lleva teléfono celular, así que nunca podría sonar como el fotógrafo. Tiene teléfono celular, pero siempre lo tiene apagado. No, tiene una particularidad que creo que se manifestó muy bien en la propuesta de los comentarios, es que tiene una doble formación, o sea, tiene una formación humanista, básicamente en filosofía, filosofía de la ciencia, filosofía de la mente, y también en programación. Él está desarrollando ahora una herramienta nueva, que a lo mejor podemos hacer preguntas sobre eso, porque está muy insatisfecho con las herramientas que existen, con los administradores de contenido, que son lineales, secuenciales, copiados del mundo real, que no ayudan a generar ninguno de los entornos de personalización, ni mucho menos una personalización en el diseño de contenidos, el diseño de actividades. Y entonces, él, con un grupo de investigadores y de programadores en Canadá, está generando una herramienta nueva. Lo que demuestra que cuando uno tiene esta doble formación, o cuando tiene esta doble inscripción, ¿no? O sea, la capacidad crítica de las humanidades, pero la capacidad performativa de la ciencia, entonces lo que se puede hacer es no simplemente criticar, sino generar alternativas, y que esas alternativas estén fundamentadas sólidamente, como quedó demostrado sobremanera hoy, de esta combinación. Creo que entonces él como persona muestra el tipo de profesional que a mi entender tendríamos que formar nosotros, gente que sea bialfabetizada en ciencias y humanidades. Una de las grandes tragedias de la enseñanza, especialmente en la universidad, es que están totalmente divididos. Por un lado, la gente que hace pero no piensa, entre comillas. Por otro lado, los que piensan pero que no hacen, entre comillas, ¿no? Demasiadas comillas. Así que bueno, paso, creo que habrá muchas cosas para charlar, para preguntarle, para inquirir. Un dato estadístico, cuando hicieron el curso en el año 2008, Conectivismo y Conocimiento Conectado, ese curso tuvo como un doble destinatario. 30 personas de una universidad en Canadá que se acreditaban con ese curso, o sea, que necesitaban los puntos para ponerlos en el currículum, y más de 2.000 personas en línea que lo hicieron por la libre. Lo que tuvo de curioso el curso es que simultáneamente se pudo hacer formal e informal, se pudo hacer acreditado y no acreditado, y la cantidad de gente quedó muchísima. En ese primer curso, y Stephen lo marcó bastante, hubo 171 personas de una calidad intelectual excepcional que desarrollaron webblogs propios, no para acompañar el curso, sino para enriquecer el curso o para codiseñar el curso. O sea, los docentes en muchos sentidos estaban al nivel de Stephen, manteniendo las proporciones, no eran alumnos, no se planteaban como alumnos, se planteaban como personas que pueden co-crear conocimiento, pueden codiseñar conocimiento. El segundo curso fue más acotado, hubo 800 personas, y ahora el que propone para este año, a partir de junio, para el cual están todos invitados a cruzarlo, porque es en línea, gratuito, libre, etc., se va a llamar alfabetizaciones críticas, critical literacy, ¿no?
Yeah.
Alfabetizaciones críticas, así que creo que es una oportunidad para todo el mundo que escuchó y que le interesó lo que está diciendo él, no solamente escuchar, sino practicar, como dijo él todo el tiempo, ¿no? Hay que meterse, hay que sumergirse, hay que sentirse como el pescado dentro del agua, ¿no? Sabiendo que es agua y que es pescado. Preguntas, comentarios. Stephen está acá para que lo exprimamos como un limón, un melón, algo más grande, una sandía, no sé. Algo. Porque tiene mucho para contarnos, mucha experiencia.
Thanks.
Y mucha generosidad en transmitir todo lo que está haciendo. Bien, ¿quién empieza?
Que hable, por favor, del shock del pasado.
What you mentioned, Rosario, the shock of the past.
The
shock of the past.
Oh, yeah, past shock. Yeah. That's... Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. Yeah, past shock is kind of a fun concept. I made it up in Rosario, so I don't remember all of the details. Was it Rosario or Cordova?
Yeah,
okay. It was Rosario, okay. The idea is that you're overwhelmed by information. You're always falling behind. You're never caught up. You can, you know, hardly keep track of your own calendar. You can't remember enough anymore because there are too many facts in the world. You can't keep track of all the people that you know. You forget. You're always hurried. You're always busy. You don't get enough sleep. You never get away from work. This is what Alvin Toffler used to call future shock. Right, but now we're in the future, and this today in the future is the result of living in the past using old methods and old technologies, and so I've called it past shock. And past shock, the cure for past shock is to incorporate new technologies into your own life, to organize your calendar using Google Calendar or something like that, to use a contact tracker to keep track of your contacts, but also to think of and approach knowledge in a different way. The old saying is, it's not a reservoir, it's a river. And to realize that tomorrow there will be just as much knowledge as there was today, and it will all be different. So there's no point trying to capture today's knowledge and hold it and keep it for yourself, but rather to sample it, to drink from it, but to let it go. And it's this being able to let it go that is how we adapt to the future and avoid past shock.
No seguimos la metodología de Stephen paso a paso, pero incorporamos muchas de las cosas que comentó. Así que le voy a pedir a Ivana Daime, que está acá, que haga un comentario acerca de las analogías y diferencias que vio entre lo que nosotros hicimos y lo que Stephen planteó hoy.
Bueno, la verdad es que hay
muchas
puntos en contacto y hay muchísimas diferencias, ¿no? También, como Diego Leal, nosotros no pensamos, quizás porque venimos de un curso formal y venimos también con nuestra propia historia, en la cual fuimos educados con un método y también educamos siguiendo ese método, se nos hace bastante difícil esto de just let it go, o sea, de leer, bueno, a ver qué pasa, tiramos textos, tiramos autores y a ver qué pasa. También quizás porque enfocamos y en, estando en una facultad, digamos, de ciencias sociales, en las cuales generalmente todo pasa por la palabra y por la palabra escrita, enfocamos mucho en la producción y en el pensar con imágenes. Entonces, creo que si veo la diferencia más grande por ahí entre el colectivismo o los cursos del colectivismo y los nuestros son que trabajamos mucho con la idea de que lo que teníamos que tener al final era una producción y que esa producción tenía que ser audiovisual, sobre todo para tratar de despegarnos y empezar a descubrir otras formas de presentar el conocimiento que iba más allá del escrito. Después hay muchas similitudes, o sea, lo que nosotros tratamos de hacer dentro del proyecto Facebook fue abandonar ese modelo broadcast de educación. Es decir, durante mucho tiempo nosotros hablamos de tecnologías que permitían la participación, de usos sociales de la tecnología, de la conexión en red, de audiencia participativa, pero lo hacíamos de un modo un poco participativo. Y de alguna manera lo que nos dimos cuenta es que no podíamos simplemente a través de la enunciación de un cambio de época, llamar a la participación, sino que viene a repensar todo, y que viene enseñando un dispositivo de participación. Y la verdad es que nos encontramos algunas de esas sorpresas en las cuales sí hicimos de todo, porque muchas de las cosas que nos encontramos fueron una sorpresa que no estaba pensada por nosotros. Pero son, creo, una de las mejores cosas que encontramos. Alejandro mencionaba que hay algunos de los desafíos de la educación actual, que se menciona la falta de participación. Esto no solo pasa en la educación solamente, sino en las redes sociales. Y creo que este dispositivo, digamos, que armamos, iba en ese camino, digamos, para estaba pensado como un dispositivo para la participación, en una educación participativa y para la participación. Así que bueno, creo que ahí son los puntos. Algunos puntos en común y obviamente otros que tengo también.
Sí, había una pregunta acá.
If you're wondering, if you're wondering what I'm doing, I'm trying to offer simultaneous translation over UStream. Hey? Okay, go ahead.
Vos, tenías una pregunta.
Sí. How what are you doing in English?
In English.
Okay. When you talk about the teaching and learning of languages, sports, and music, using the instruments, how does that work in the mind, in the neural networks? Because you said you want to ride a bicycle, good. So how does it work? How does the social connection?
Okay. So basically the connection, how does the mechanism of immersion work? So how do you generate knowledge out of immersion in a community? And the answer to that is not simple, obviously. There are mechanisms or principles of association that describe how connections are formed between neurons. Now, these mechanisms or principles would differ a little bit from one type of network to another type of network. So there will be mechanisms that are unique and specific to human memory, and slightly different mechanisms that work for social knowledge or social memory. But I've identified four major types of connection. That's not to say that there aren't. There's four major types of association. That's not to say that there aren't other types of association, but these are four that seem to me to play important roles in both social learning and in personal learning. The first type is Hebbian learning, named after the Canadian psychologist Donald Hebb. And basically, that's the idea that if two neurons are stimulated at the same time and not stimulated at the same time, they will form a connection. It's kind of like an idea, you know, the idea of things that are similar attract each other. In society, we would see people who have similar interests tend to form associations with each other. The second form of association is proximity. This is the idea that things that are near to each other will form a link together. In Rummelhart and McClellan's book, Parallel Distributed Processing, they describe this kind of connection forming to create pools or clusters in their jets and sharks example. And so this is an essential way of creating categorizations and groupings of things. In social communities, you form connections with your next door neighbors. You form connections with people who are near to you. I've seen research that shows that the people you fall in love with and marry are people who were proximate to you, or people who were local to you, which is why, you know, people marry the girl next door, because she's next door. The third type of association is known as back propagation in connectionist literature. This is the idea of correctives or feedback mechanisms. Use the first two mechanisms to form a web of connections, and then that produces some output. And the output produces a reaction, and the reaction is fed back through the network. And this affects the strength of the connections between the different entities. So it's almost like a wave beating against a platform or a wall, right? The wave hits the wall, and then there's a ripple wave that comes back, and you get a new pattern of refraction. So, and in social learning, again, feedback, criticism, commentary, these are all ways that we see the connections between ourselves and our knowledge being refined and explored. And then finally, the fourth form of association is based on principles of thermodynamics. In connectionist literature, it's known as Boltzmann associationism. It's based on the Boltzmann principles of thermodynamics. And basically, it's the idea of the network settling into the most stable thermodynamics configuration, settling into the state of least expended energy. It's almost like the principle of laziness in thought, but really, when actually applied, it's like finding harmony, finding balance, you know, making everything, you know, getting rid of the contradictions. And what this is basically a process by which the connections between individual neurons settle into the lowest possible state. Now, in Boltzmann mechanisms, there's a process called annealing, where what you do is you stimulate and then you let it settle, and then you stimulate and then you let it settle. And this is like the process of hardening metal by heating it and then letting it cool, right? It's the same sort of thing. You make it settle into a more stable configuration by agitating it first. In social networks, this is like community seeking peace and tranquility and getting along with your neighbors and things like that. But every once in a while, you need some sort of shakeup, you need an election, you need a discussion, some sort of way of redefining the links and the boundaries between communities. Those four mechanisms of association, they're very simple mechanisms of association. They form connections between individual pairs of neurons and then larger and larger clusters of neurons. And there are mechanisms. A lot of these are described by Rummel, Hart, and McClellan. Others are described by Marvin Minsky and Seymour Papert, who have also done a lot of work in this area. You form more advanced cognitive phenomena through combinations of these individual things. Give you a little example. Numbers, we recognize numbers by their shapes, or, you know, in audio by their sound, and these numbers combine, and there are forms of associationist mathematics. The original associationist mathematics was described by John Stuart Mill in Mill's Axioms, and you can describe much more advanced forms of associationist mathematics, as, for example, described by Philip Kitcher in his book, The Nature of Mathematical Knowledge. And again, it's the idea here is you think of mathematics not as relationships between sentences or propositions or entities like numbers, but rather as sequences of operations, of patterns of behavior that you repeat. So this is based on the philosophical principle of operationalism in mathematics. And that's one way of creating mathematical knowledge through associationist principles. So it gets really kind of hard and messy to describe, right? But basically, you work from these very simple associationist principles and gradually build up to these more higher and more complex ideas. One more thing before I stop, because this is important. And this is the subject of abstraction or generalization. Traditionally, we think of abstraction or generalization as a process of induction. We see a duck, 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 we conclude all ducks are white, right? But in fact, abstraction is the opposite of that. Abstraction is a process of subtraction. We see a duck, we take away from our concept of a duck everything but its color, and we get the idea that ducks are white. And this is important because logically, you can't get to the generalization from the induction. And there's a century of philosophy in the 20th century they tried to prove this. It was known as the problem of induction. You can't get there from here. You can't get to generalizations through induction. The only way to get through generalizations is to take something specific and then remove concepts from it, remove elements from it. And the only way to do that is to think of these things sub-symbolically, to think of these things as though they were patterns of perception. And this is, in fact, how we process sensory data. When visual data comes in through our eye and into the back of our head, the visual cortex is back here, it goes through a series of connections of networks. And basically what these connections of networks do is they filter or draw out different elements. It was David Meyer talks about the 2.5D sketch. And basically there's a process of edge detection. There are neurons that all they do is detect edges. And so they're taking away all the rest of the knowledge. They detect an edge, and that's how we come up with the concept of an object, is we find edges. Oh, that's objects. So that is the kind of process. So the actual mechanisms are different, but the outcome is, the complex language and mathematics and ontology and other high-level knowledge that we have today.
La respuesta es densa, porque tiene que ver con, él mencionó a varios autores, fundamentalmente a David Ramapar y James McLellan, que son autores de una obra que está traducida al castellano del año 1987 que se llama Procesamiento distribuido en paralelo. Y lo interesante del planteo de Stephen es que estas cosas que eran tema de la inteligencia artificial y que tenían que ver con investigaciones muy refinadas en áreas bastante experimentales, tardan 20 años y llegan a la educación. Y entonces resulta que nosotros estamos enseñando y aprendiendo, pero estoy enseñando con teorías del cerebro de hace 30 o 50 años atrás. Y por eso se dan estos desaciertos. Y por eso estamos trabajando con teorías psicológicas como el constructivismo, o el constructivismo declamado pero nunca practicado, ¿no? Entonces, cuando uno está metido, en como está Stephen, en la crema y en el corazón de estas teorías, que son todas no representacionalistas. ¿Qué quiere decir? Que plantean que no hay objetos externos independientes de los observadores, sino que fundamentalmente lo que hay es una construcción colaborativa. Y también otra cosa muy importante que para la gente que está metida en el mundo de la computación y de las redes cada día más clara, pero para la gente que está afuera no se dan cuenta, es que todo el mundo sigue creyendo que la única forma de generar conocimiento es a través de los formatos lógicos tradicionales, que son la inducción y la deducción. O sea, partir de lo particular y llegar a lo general, o partir de lo general y llegar a lo particular. Cualquier persona que sabe algo de innovación o de descubrimiento, de invención, sabe que en general los descubrimientos o las invenciones se hacen por abducción, y la abducción tiene que ver fundamentalmente con esa capacidad increíble que tiene Dr. House a partir de un indicio, como decía recién Stephen, de un edge, algo que nadie vio, un borde, que no tiene nada que ver con nada, y de repente dice, ah, pero esto tiene que ver con esto, con esto, con esto, ¿no? Los docentes no conocen estas cosas, los que las practican, y los pedagogos no tienen ni idea de lo que está pasando, ¿no? Pero siguen vendiendo lo que se llamaba en inglés snake oil, aceite cúralo todo, ¿no? Que no cura nada, por supuesto, que sigue enfermando. Acá tenemos una pregunta que hizo Diego, dirigida a Cifes, que dice: I found most students prefer to be taught by an expert. What would the connectivist in middle ground look like?
Sorry, say that last again.
I found most students prefer to be taught by an expert. Right. What would a connectivist middle ground look like?
What would the connectivist? Well, I mean, there's still teaching by experts, but the teaching looks different. Because instead of the expert getting up in the front of the room and lecturing to them, although that can happen, right? This is not eliminated entirely, but it becomes only a very small part of the overall activity. Rather, the expert performs the discipline within that disciplinary community. So the lawyer tries cases. The philosopher philosophizes. The geographer creates maps. The psychologist does psychology. And they do these openly. They conduct these practices openly and reflectively, documenting what they've done, documenting how they do what they do. This is why, as an aside, this is why I have my website. This is why on my website I've put up my talks that I give. I write blog posts. You know, somebody in our organization asks me to defend a project. I write a letter to defend the project and I blog it. Which is always kind of fun. I get asked to do surveys, right? So I do the survey and then I blog my survey. The idea here is to work openly. And by working openly as part of this community, other people who are students, people who are learning, see me do the practice of research in my discipline. And they see that practice and then they're able to emulate that practice, you know, to whatever degree they feel comfortable with. And so the interaction starts. They tentatively try to interact with the community in ways that they've seen other people interact with the community. It's very often a process of imitation, but you know, eventually it'll become a process of improvisation. It's, if you ever watch jazz musicians, watch the new guy in the jazz club, right? So, you get the old guys are like 80 years old and they're playing on the trumpet and on the saxophone. They're just doing their thing. I don't even like jazz music, but I like watching it, right? They're doing this. And then there's this new guy, right? He's like, 16 years old. His saxophone is still shiny. And he very tentatively, he'll join. He's watching them very closely for signals and cues. He might play a little backbeat, boom, boom, just contributing a little bit. Gradually, as he feels more comfortable, he contributes more. He becomes more of the group. And eventually, through this practice and gradual increasing engagement with people who are already fully engaged, this person becomes an accomplished jazz musician, right? And you can't tell somebody, here's how you join a jazz group, right? You can sit there and describe it all day, but you have to go through this process. It's the same with sports teams. First the person is a third stringer. They might be playing on the third division team, subbing everyone. Gradually, they are able to become more and more engaged. As they become more and more engaged, you're able to recognize that, this is a good player. They become more and more, but they watch and observe the experts who are already playing. I used to play darts a lot. I don't know if you have darts. I saw a dartboard in my hotel. So,
Dardos.
That's a good name. Of course, here I am commenting on the adequacy of the Spanish word for a subject. And again, you learn to play darts by watching people who are already very good at darts and trying to imitate what they do, right? And then you imitate it a lot. And you practice and you practice and you practice. All the practice in the world, you still have to play games against the experts. And it's playing the games against the experts, that's what gets you good. That's what really improves your game. And now you're engaged in this interaction, right? I'm playing what's his name? Really famous dart player, I've forgotten his name. Phil Taylor, right? And actually playing Phil the Power Taylor in a dart tournament, Canadian Open, right? And of course he smokes me, right? To play somebody like that and you watch and the guy gets up, thunk, 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 180. And you go, oh my goodness, yeah. But yeah, you're watching it and you're learning it and you realize you have to acquire this through years of practice and engagement, and you just learn, and you just throw those darts, and it's not knowing how to do it, it's the feel, thunk, 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 and that's how you play darts. Every discipline is like that.
Diego Leal, que sigue, parece que estuviera más acá que nosotros, está más presente como Vicente. Nos recomienda que leamos un libro que se llama Brain Rules, de John Medina, 12 Principles for Surviving and Thriving at Work, Home and School. Brain Rules está en brainrules.net. Y muchas de las cosas que estuvo comentando recién Stephen están ligadas a un descubrimiento neurológico reciente que se llama Neuronas Espejo. Neuronas Espejo, hay un libro de Marco Iacoboni que se llama Las Neuronas Espejo, Empatía, Neuropolítica, Autismo, Imitación o de Cómo Entendemos a los Otros. O sea, y estas cosas van saliendo. Alguien en Colombia dice algo, Río de Janeiro, nosotros lo tomamos, pegamos en la web. Y esto es imposible hace 2 años atrás, 5 años atrás. Una forma de vuelta de cómo el aprendizaje colectivo, cooperativo, a distancia, etc. Bueno, tenemos tiempo para una pregunta más cortita o dos y ya vamos cerrando. Gino atrás.
En nuestro sistema educativo, y creo que en la mayoría de los sistemas educativos del mundo, los docentes están acostumbrados a enseñar, ¿no? Y ese es uno de los grandes problemas. Entonces, la pregunta concreta es si el colectivismo se da un método diferenciado o deberíamos tener un método diferenciado para enseñarle a los docentes a pensar de manera diferente todos estos problemas. Digo, yo participé del proyecto Facebook como alumno y nosotros empezamos a pensar de otra manera los problemas que tenían que ver con el método de estudio, o con el objeto de estudio que era Facebook, o con el método de analizar eso. Y el tema es ver de qué manera los docentes, que por ahí no están relacionados de ninguna manera con este tipo de tecnología, pueden empezar a pensar los problemas en esta clave.
Yeah, this is kind of the subject of the presentation that I did in Cordoba and I did in Rosario, and so you'll find those online. The idea here is that what I've tried to do with teachers, and this is often the approach when I'm speaking with a group of teachers, is to talk not about how they can improve their teaching, but rather how they can improve their learning. And I tell them, and I tell them this quite honestly, I don't care about their teaching. And well, I do, but I don't, right? What I really want them to be able to do is to come out of the talk with a better way for them to learn themselves. And I talk about ways of dealing with information that are typically supported through the internet that help them improve their own teaching and learning. And the first of these is interactivity and how to get better interactivity, because traditionally teachers do not have good interactivity with other members of their profession or you know, researchers in their profession. So I talk about methods to improve interactivity. Another thing I talk about is what I call usability, which is basically making the information in your life simple and easier to organize and more consistent. And I talk about methods teachers can use, sometimes using new technologies like content management systems or whatever, but just to take control of their own information, their own vocabulary even, and to manage it for themselves. And then the third thing is relevance, to talk to them about having ways of getting the right kind of information where and when they want it. And this relates a lot to this past shock that I was talking about, dealing with information as a flow, dealing with information is something that changes a lot. And throughout that, I talk about ways of using the internet to improve this. But the important thing here is that your attitude toward these things changes, right? When you realize that if you had these tools, you could be more interactive, you could take more control of your knowledge, you could get information when and where you want it. If you later take the tool away, you still have this attitude toward your own learning. It's almost like the internet becomes a scaffold to dealing with learning in a better way in your own life. And that's the way I present it to them. So they don't need to depend on the internet in order to seek interactivity. There's all kinds of ways to seek interactivity. We're listening to some now. I'm just kidding. But it doesn't matter, right? You, that's what you do. You find your own ways of interacting. You don't have to have the internet to organize your own knowledge. I used sheets of paper. I'd tape sheets of paper together, make big, huge diagrams, and organize it my own way. So I had my own representation of all of knowledge. I'm like that. But you don't have to do all of knowledge, right? You can do a different domain or discipline or whatever. But you represent it your own way. And your own way of having your own knowledge when and where you need it, whether it's little books like this, note cards, little tips and tricks for remembering things, all kinds of ways for you to manage your own knowledge. And it's the attitude of taking control of your own knowledge that the internet supports, but is not necessary in the end to have.
Última.
Tiene una opinión que tiene sobre esto. El sistema educativo es un dispositivo social que más objetivos sociales de conocimiento. ¿Es posible que tenga en cuenta objetivos personales? ¿Podemos hacer modificación al sistema con nuestra estructura? Es una contradicción.
Yeah. It's really hard to be an individual inside a group, isn't it? Especially when all the mechanisms and systems are structured to create conformity rather than expressiveness. That doesn't mean it's impossible, but it does mean that you really have to reconfigure your understanding. In Canada, a number of educational systems have adopted more student-centered and constructivist approaches to learning. Ontario and Quebec especially have adopted constructivist methodologies, which have proven to be very effective. You can do things in traditional educational settings like media literacy. In my own province of New Brunswick, they're doing a 21st century literacies program along with the regular curriculum. And of course, the course that I'm doing with Rita Kopp is on critical literacies. And it's not really in a formal setting, but you can do this sort of thing in a formal setting. You know, a lot of my own ideas about this did emerge out of, you know, working in a traditional structure. The interventions need to be right. You need to promote, you know, autonomy and diversity in a classroom, which is very hard to do. You need to give people the opportunity to create, and also, more importantly, the opportunity to fail. And, you know, I had some really, really interesting failures. One of our classes was sort of an open class, and we set up a model society, and I was the banker. And that's when I learned that I was not cut out to be a banker. And my bank failed, and our entire economy collapsed. But you know, because it was an open elective course, I didn't get an F for failing my bank. It's just, this is what happened. We had a model parliament, and I was thrown out of office by the Governor General for, well, outlawed the opposition parties. And anyhow, you know, things like that. You know, you can have failures, you have experiments, and these things will lead to a certain degree to the sort of independence and self-sufficiency, but, you know, generally they go against the grain of the system, don't they? And generally, it's hard to maintain and to foster that sort of thing inside an institutional structure, and generally the institution eventually pushes back. And so when I'm asked, where do I think the greatest change of this new type of learning and new technologies will take place, my answer generally is outside the schools. And it raises the question, how do we maintain our culture and our community at all if learning in the future is taking place outside the school? you know, because now we don't have this captive audience anymore. Not that we ever really did, but I guess if you repeat something to a group of people often enough, they'll actually come to believe it, albeit rather uncritically. But when they're outside the classroom, it's harder to get at them. Of course, advertisers know how to do this, right? And they manage to get messages right into people's heads, even though they don't have them in a classroom. We have to become smarter about how we propagate social and community values. We have to foster in our community programs, products, creative acts, cultural events, the values that we want to see fostered in society. We actually have to represent them in society. We have to, as an older generation, instantiate and be the kind of society that we want our young people to become. And that's historically has been a very tall order, because our ideals very often outreach our abilities, and as a society we do not always set the best model for our young, and we have to be more attentive to that in the future, much more attentive to that in the past, and our behavior as a society is going to have to match our lofty ambitions.
Bueno, parece que la pregunta, el comentario final de Luz, puso el dedo en la llaga, porque está muy bien tener todas estas teorías innovadoras, pero cuando uno tiene que bajar las instituciones conservadoras, no la escuela en particular, sino la institución como tal, ¿no? Que tiene valores sociales por encima de los personales, es difícil articularlo. De todas maneras, y aprovechando este cierre de intervención, creo que el ejemplo de este libro, como proyección colectiva, ¿no? Porque en definitiva este libro, fíjense, se llama Proyecto Facebook y la Postuniversidad, Sistemas Operativos Sociales y Entornos Abiertos de Aprendizaje. No es un libro muy simpático, no es un libro muy institucional, al revés, es un libro que está bastante a contrapelo de lo que se hace en la universidad, de lo que hace en la institución, y curiosamente fue financiado por la Fundación Telefónica, que en definitiva es una parte de Telefónica en sí mismo. Fue propuesto, pero... Sí, pero, claro, no, pero la fundación lo financió, digo. Sí. Ah, y fue un diseño colaborativo. Diseño colaborativo. Y atrás, entonces quiero mencionar a una persona que no está acá, aparte de Alejandrina y todo el equipo de fundación que trabajó como locos para sacar esto en tiempo récord, porque se presentaron los originales como habíamos convenido, el 1 de febrero, y contra el tiempo de locura, tenemos un producto en 2 meses de una calidad excepcional. Atrás de todo esto también está involucrada una persona, que es José de la Peña Aznar, que es el articulador, el coordinador del área de debate y conocimiento de Fundación Telefónica en España, que ha llevado adelante un ciclo de 10 charlas impresionantes, habiendo llevado a España a gente como Clay Shirky o como Steven Weinberger, y que se va a cerrar con una charla de Raymond Kurzweil, gente que o no había estado nunca en España o había estado en lugares de no el nivel de relevancia y exposición que implica estar en una actividad de la Fundación Telefónica. Así que bueno, agradezco especialmente a la Fundación Telefónica, a la Embajada de Canadá, a todos los integrantes del proyecto Facebook, a Stephen Naus, e invito a los que puedan y quieran estar esta tarde a las 3 y media de la tarde en la Feria del Libro, donde va a ser el bautismo formal de nuestro querido hijo, que tiene tantos padres, madres, tías, abuelos, que yo... No sé, es un problema de polinseminización, ¿no? Muchísimas gracias a todos. Buenos días.
And that's going to wrap up our live broadcast. So thanks to you who are still here. We had 211 people overall come in and out of the talk. It kept increasing, yeah, it did. So thanks everyone. I'm going to stop the recording and stop the broadcasting. So it's around lunchtime for you. Go out and have a good lunch. If it's not, have yourself a good day. Thanks everyone. Talk to you later.